create for you an experience of some Viennese music lovers one day in 1795. If you saw the little note on your program, you know the story. Beethoven essentially produced a GoFundMe where he proposed that people could get his very special Opus 1 trios by coming directly to his house and paying him, I forget you have the price there, I imagine that all these people were very eager waiting for the day when Artaya produced these copies for them. You know, this was the first publication of this 25-year-old Wunderkind who'd arrived in Vienna not that long ago. I imagine that the three trios really were designed by him to show off his full range as a composer, even if they may not have been designed to be played one after another in a single evening, as we're doing here. One thing for sure, I'm pretty sure you wouldn't have wanted to have been present when those players first opened their parts, because the music is very demanding to play, even now, more than 200 years after the pieces were written. But I'm sure that those subscribers were really blown away. And let's imagine that some days of strenuous practicing later, practicing and some careful rehearsing too, that these people were ready to invite their friends over to see what they got for their investment. And it isn't a program, I've never heard anybody program this before. It's not a program that a piano trio today would ever organize. Usually one of these early Beethoven trios would open a program and then it would feature, I don't know, one of the big romantic chestnuts, Tchaikovsky trio, or one of the big Schubert or Mendelssohn trios or something. Even a group that wanted to perform all of the Beethoven trios, I imagine you would mix and match and put an early one together with a later one or something. But my idea was really to see what they would have been like for those people in 1795 who put their money on the line. And I actually find it quite exhilarating to play them one after another, and I hope you will enjoy them too. One of the things that I think is pretty clear is that they become increasingly complex. I mean, this one was not simple by any means, but you'll see that the complexity builds up. All three of them are in four movements, which is more typical of a symphony than a sonata form, chamber music piece. And the other thing about this one that you just heard, I feel like the very exuberant outer movements, that's the kind of music you'd expect from a young composer. But I wouldn't have expected that slow movement, which I find really, really extraordinary, especially from a 25-year-old. So we're now turning towards the second trio. I should warn you, our plan is, because it's three relatively equal length pieces, we thought it would be a little bit weird to put an intermission either after one or with only one left. So what I thought we would do, we'll play the second trio, have just a quick 3 or 4 minute stretch. I have a few things to say about the third trio, and then we'll go on. So the second trio actually is my favorite one, and maybe it's because I tend to root for the underdogs. I think it's by far the least played of the three pieces, but it has a slow introduction that I like very much, also kind of symphonic idea. And the slow movement, if anything, is even more accomplished than the one in the first trio. And I hope you enjoy it.
Thank you.
third trio, I want to share a little anecdote with you. Apparently, before the publication, Haydn was present for a read-through of the three trios, and everybody was very nervous. What was Haydn going to think? And apparently he was very pleased with the first two, but reportedly suggested to Beethoven that he should withhold the publication of the third one, the one that we're about to play. And Beethoven was really mad, and he assumed that Haydn was perhaps just jealous. In any case, Beethoven's friend Ries was so surprised that he actually went up to Haydn and said, "Is it true that you said that?" And he said, "Yes." He said, "This piece," he thought, "would never find favor with the Viennese public," the one you're about to hear. It's for sure in a very, very different mood from the other two. The minor key tells us that right away. But I suspect that it may have something to do with the ending, that both of the first two trios end with a great explosion, virtuosic line. And the third one, you will see if you don't know the piece, I will, just spoiler alert, it ends quietly, finishes with a kind of a quiet puff of smoke. And it's interesting because in this trio, really, it seems to me it is the last movement that has the greatest weight, and it reminds me of a Shakespearean tragedy at the end. Everybody is dead, and we are just left contemplating the wreckage.